morning, Berks County. I'm your host, Jill Zielinski, Director of Supports Coordination from the ARC Alliance. Thank you so much for being here with us today. With me is Scott Camilleri, the Executive Director of the ARC Alliance Foundation. And today's show is on the ARC Alliance Did You Know? Hopefully by the end of the show today, you'll have a full understanding of what individuals we serve, what services we provide, and how anyone can be involved with the ARC. I'd like to start off by reading the mission statement. And the ARC Alliance envisions a society that has appropriate supports, services, and safeguards for all people with developmental disabilities so that they can fully participate in our community. We strive to ensure legal protections for people with developmental disabilities are upheld, developed, and utilized to further inclusive and supportive communities. The ARC Alliance Advocacy Services believes that all people have the right to participate in society, to be productive, to develop and maintain relationships, and to have opportunities to pursue their dreams. Over 6 million people are diagnosed with developmental disabilities. 1 in 110 children are diagnosed with autism, which makes it more prevalent than childhood cancer, juvenile diabetes, and pediatric AIDS combined. So now I'd like to turn it over to Scott to please introduce yourself and let us know what you do for the ARC.
Well, thanks, Jill. It's great to be here. I've now been with the ARC a whopping a little over 6 months. And so as an expert with long credentials about those issues, I'm not really prepared for. But for this show, I think it really gave me an opportunity to come. And as you, the viewer, not knowing maybe a lot about the ARC and who we serve and how you can be involved, somebody who's only been there 6 months really can be an expert. So in fact, my wife is a teacher, and my first experience was with the ARC, was unbeknownst to me. She has meetings with students and with parents, and she would also say to me that other folks would come into the meeting and be there to help the family navigate what was going on. Well, at that time, I didn't know that that person was from the ARC. But now that I've been here, now I know kind of where the ARC is and what they do. So over the last 6 months, I've grown to understand and hope that today that you'll have a clear understanding of the ARC and the ARC Alliance, who we serve, and how you can be involved with the ARC. I also act as the executive director of the ARC Alliance Foundation, and that gives me the opportunity to be here to help and communicate to the broader community what we do, those things that are important to the ARC, as well as share awareness and, as you might imagine, raise funds so that the ARC Alliance and its associated agencies can fulfill their mission and proceed with their vision.
Scott's going to talk about how long the ARC has been in existence, but we still do get a lot of questions, a lot of phone calls coming in where people ask us, what is the ARC and what is the ARC Alliance? And I had mentioned in previous shows that the ARC did have a name change. We did change our name for the four corporations to begin with the ARC Alliance. But Scott, could you let us know what is the ARC?
Yeah, well, the ARC itself is a very large organization. In fact, it's the world's largest community-based organization serving those people with intellectual and developmental disabilities. We provide an array of services and supports for families and individuals from birth throughout life. And as I was saying earlier, my wife, in her job setting and dealing with family in an academic setting, you would think, ooh, the ARC works with that one segment. But it's good to note that we work with families and individuals from birth throughout their life. So that means the ARC is working with those at infancy and the family, working with folks as they transition into school and academics, and then throughout their lives into an adult and elder years. So the ARC instead of focusing in one little area, has the experience from birth through life. The ARC is devoted to developing, or I'm sorry, to promoting and improving supports and services for those people we serve. The ARC's vision is that every individual and family affected by intellectual and developmental disabilities in the United States has access to the information, advocacy, and skills they need to participate as active members of their community. And I think that is another important piece, that everyone has that opportunity to participate in their community and be active members in their community. The ARC has over 140,000 members, which then you can see how it can become one of the largest organizations dealing with this group. We also have 730 local and state chapters across the nation. And therefore, when you look at the ARC US, which is our parent organization based in Washington, D.C., really oversees all the activity throughout the United States. But then they're broken down by state. So we also have connection with the ARC of Pennsylvania, which is housed in, or located in Harrisburg. And they really provide for us the connection with legislators and provide us direction in that way. And then you break it down into each community. And here the ARC Alliance covers more than just one county. We cover several counties, from Berks, Montgomery, Bucks, and pieces of others as well. So you can see how large the ARC is, and then how through the structure really focuses on the local community, and that's where the ARC Alliance is focused. Within the ARC Alliance, we've broken it up into different categories, different areas of support. And so Children's Services really works with families from infancy through 3 years old. And there are a lot of issues that take place with children as they're developing, and we're there to help them. Then from that transition from three into academics and through the balance of their life, the ARC Alliance Advocacy Services really picks up and works with families and individuals at that point. And then finally, my area, the ARC Alliance Foundation, again, really supports those others by raising funds, raising awareness, and inviting people in to participate with the ARC Alliance.
So we've been around for a long time, and originally the ARC was started by a group of concerned parents. Scott, could you please just let us know what are some of the values of the ARC and what does the ARC stand for?
Yeah, well, throughout its history, the ARC is now over 60 years old. There have been many changes. But today, the ARC is really driven by opportunity. The opportunity for hope, for growth, and for change. The opportunity for everyone to become a valued, contributing member of their community. And that, again, is one of the most strategic pieces, that we value the individual, but we value the community, and that every individual has that opportunity and right to participate in their community.
And Scott, I'm sorry to interrupt you right there, but it seems that a train has gone by while you were in the middle of saying that. So would you just please repeat the last section?
Oh, sure.
Thank you.
Again, over those 60 years, and the ARC's transitions and changes, but today the ARC is really driven by opportunity. And as I was saying, the opportunity for hope, for growth, and for change, and the opportunity for everyone to become a valued, contributing member of their community. And Jill is saying that the community component is extremely important. We value that individuals can participate on many levels within their community, and that's what we want to promote. The ARC fosters respect and access for individuals with intellectual and developmental disabilities and their families, giving them the power to achieve full and satisfying lives. Our collective voice, so those we serve plus those that are members, that 140,000 plus, provides the opportunity for all of us to make a difference.
And I originally took over this show in an effort to overcome my stage fright, but I really hope that I'm doing the ARC justice. And you'll notice that we really do keep reiterating that the ARC works on community integration, which is the individuals accessing the community, giving a voice to individuals, and empowering them to become full and contributing members of their society. So hopefully I'm doing that justice. And Scott, could you let us know when the ARC was founded?
Well, as Jill mentioned earlier, it was founded by 8 families, and that was over 60 years ago in 1950. And those families found themselves, like many today, isolated, alone, not knowing what to do, what services there were. And certainly 60 years ago, there were many less opportunities for families to integrate their children into the community. And they started, those 8 families, and really laid out just a few points of interest for them, the things that they wanted to accomplish. I think it's worthwhile just to read those to you, and many of them are still with us today. First, they wanted to promote the general welfare of those with intellectual and developmental disabilities. And even now, as you reflect on these last few weeks in Philadelphia, the welfare of several individuals that were taken advantage of. The ARC is there for them, that was one of the things that these families were very concerned about. Who's going to take care of the welfare of these folks? To further the advancement of research and therapy, to develop a better understanding, to further educate and train professionals. And we do that with our experience, and the ARC Alliance has 80 plus professionals who have many decades of experience for you when you come into areas that you don't know what to do. To encourage membership, aid parents, and coordinate activities. To encourage and implement legislation. Extremely important as we see budgets, as we see legislation come through state and federal. Who's there to put pressure on legislators to take care of those with intellectual and developmental disabilities and delays? To gather and disseminate information and to develop integrated programs for those with intellectual and developmental disabilities. And again, why I'm here at times, to solicit funds. So even back 60 years ago, they knew that the government wouldn't be supporting everything, but that provided opportunities for folks to be involved, not only with funds, but to volunteer as well.
And right now we'd like to take a short break, and then we will be back to go over our name change in 60 years of history.
You're watching The ARC, Building Bridges in the Community on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information on local issues, go to bctv.org.
Thank you for coming back with us. What you're looking at right now is an example of some graphics that you may be seeing on some upcoming shows. It demonstrates our values, and we hope to be able to get more information out there to you shortly. So, Scott, could you let us know that with a 60-year history, why do we have a name change and a logo change now?
A great point, Jill. Well, even at 60 years old, and as the largest charity network in the nation, The ARC is virtually unknown among members of the public. As I said earlier, before I was involved with the ARC, I really didn't know much about it. We rank, so the ARC itself ranks 96 out of the top 100 charities in the nation. So certainly, there is a positioning and a branding issue that needed to be addressed. In this past year, the ARC itself looked at it and said, yeah, we need to unify as we have around the topics for those with intellectual and developmental disabilities. We've unified there, but we need to unify in our branding so that the community knows what the ARC stands for. The new logo really helps that as chapters bring it in to unify those 730 different local and state chapters. As Paul, I was talking with Paul Stengel, the CEO of the ARC Alliance, and Paul said to me he was encouraged by the bright energy that it represents. The logo provides a sense of opportunity and optimism, the opportunity for growth as an organization, the opportunity for change, and the sense of optimism for the future. Well, the ARC itself, ARC US, is well underway in presenting its branding. They have enlisted the support of Lauren Potter, who plays Becky on the popular show Glee. And Becky is a spokesperson for the ARC, and you can see, if you go out to YouTube, you can Google or search for her and see her service announcement and her involvement with the ARC. Locally, I now have the opportunity to go and present the ARC Alliance, really communicate to the community who we are and how they can be involved, so that at one point people won't say, what does the ARC stand for? They'll know that we are for people with intellectual and developmental disabilities, and that the ARC Alliance creates opportunities, and that we invite all people, those with intellectual and developmental disabilities and delays, and those in the community, to achieve with us what we're trying to do.
And in order to get in all the information that we wanted to get in today, I'm just going to ask Scott, who does the ARC Alliance serve? And we're going to talk a little bit about the services that we do provide.
Well, it's a great question, Jill. The ARC Alliance serves the community, your community, Berks County. Within that, we serve those with intellectual and developmental delays and disabilities, which, again, when I started, I didn't know who is that. And Jill, you really have a better grasp of that. It's a pretty large group and spans a lot of different things, but why don't you, more expert, take care of that?
It is. Our advocacy, the ARC Alliance Advocacy Services, provides care for and advocacy for individuals from birth through adults. Right now we have a growing aging population that we tend to be getting a lot of phone calls on. So we're really stepping up our efforts to work with senior citizen groups and the Office of Aging and Adults. Under the umbrella of the ARC Alliance Advocacy Services, we provide our newest program, which I'm proud to say I'm the director of, which is our new Supports Coordination Program. And what Supports Coordination is when you need to access services within the Office of Developmental Programs, your Supports Coordinator is your guide for that process. They're the person that will meet with you, they will guide the team, they will let you know what services are out there, how to get them, how to sign up for them, and they will help you navigate the system. So we're now providing Supports Coordination through for anybody enrolled within the Office of Developmental Programs and the Bureau of Autism Services. We also provide advocacy, and our advocacy is generally broken up into two main sections. We have an absolutely fantastic educational advocate, Sharon Jones, who I cannot say enough wonderful things about, but Sharon is the expert with anything that has to do with education, and she helps families navigate the educational system. We also provide advocacy to the adults, and that can be any major issue or any even minor issue that somebody has in their life. We deal, of course, with the big ones of health and safety, ensuring that everybody is healthy and safe. We also advocate on a legislative level for laws that will protect the rights of the individuals. Right now, one of our major legislative goals is and I'm actually just going to read it right out, it's the need for the adult protective services in Pennsylvania. People with intellectual and developmental disabilities must be protected from harm and injury. And this can include abuse, including physical, mental, or sexual abuse, abandonment, exploitation, and neglect. So our advocates work not only to ensure that people's rights are protected throughout their school years, but also that their rights are protected throughout their entire life. We also provide legal guardianship, which is where it's where an individual has been found legally incompetent. We provide legal guardians who will assist them to make their life decisions. We also have a representative payee, where we're responsible for helping people manage their funds. So all of those are included under the blanket of the ARC Alliance Advocacy Services. I guess, Scott, could you give us a list of some of the other services available in the early intervention from birth to the age of 3?
Sure, yeah, and that is, one of those times where when you're having maybe your first child or any child and the doctor indicates that there may be a challenge, the anxiety and stress level that produces is extraordinary. But then once you transition into life with your child, the various questions that come up, we then have, again, decades worth of experience from hearing, speech, language, as a delay, should they be crawling now? What do we do from physical therapies? So our ability to really work with a family and understand what those things should be for their child, and then to connect them with the services and supports they really require. That is our children's service, early intervention, and that takes up through 3 years old. But again, from birth throughout the life of the individual is what the ARC Alliance really does. Mm-hmm. We also have, as you were saying, support groups for fathers, for siblings, for those with Down syndrome, a play group, and relatively new, a stepping stone transitions. As families transition from one stage of life to the next, those anxieties that are there can increase. So we're here to help in that transition, to gain the experience from those that have already gone through it and from those who are professionals and experience it over their time at the ARC Alliance, to provide to you what to expect as you're transitioning.
And also, in an effort to help, we are now offering trainings. We've developed a training program, and we are always looking for ideas. Anyone who would contact us and request a training on a specific topic, we absolutely can develop it. We have a number of trainings developed right now that we're able to present. And Scott, could you just let us know, before we run out of time, how people can get involved with the ARC?
Right. Great opportunity for you to be involved. When we look at folks, we're really looking at those that we serve, but those who have concerns for those with intellectual and developmental disabilities. You can volunteer. You can certainly donate to the ARC Alliance. You can do that online at thearcalliance.org. And we also have social events as well as opportunities just to see us out in public. We're at the Montgomeryville Mall. I know that's a hike out of Berks, but through December we'll be doing a gift wrap there. We also have a breakfast with Frosty and Santa, and we have several other social events that you can look at on our website. And I will say this, our website is under transition now. Not only have we transitioned name and logo, but we're also transitioning our website to be more responsive to those we serve, to our community, to the public, to provide information, connection, and ways for you to be involved in as little as 5 minutes, 15 minutes, a half an hour, and beyond. So if you just have a couple minutes and say, ooh, I can spare that, you have a place at the ARC Alliance.
Absolutely. I can't stress that enough. Please, as a non-for-profit, please remember that we absolutely would like any donations, and your time is valuable to us also. So for any more information on what we discussed today, you can contact the ARC Alliance at 610-265-4700. And I'd like to thank Scott Camilleri, the Executive Director of the ARC Alliance Foundation. And again, my name is Jill Zielinski, and I'm the Director of Supports Coordination. Please feel free to contact us with any questions that you have. Thank you.